Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
I'm going to get down on my knees and let's go before the Lord together in prayer tonight. Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, what a great night already, shouting your praise, God. How good it is to be in your house. Lord, tonight as we open up your word, we pray that you open us up to receive, God. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, and our hearts to understand. May we be the good ground where the word is sown, and may it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Lord, we just ask your Holy Spirit, we invite your Spirit to be our teacher, be our guide. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the discipline, even the correction that we need for our individual lives. And Lord, we thank you that you come and you move amongst your people this night. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, also we'd ask it for all the churches that are both preaching and teaching, hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet. They're our brothers and sisters, Lord, and at no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building your kingdom. So God, we ask that you'd bless all of our brothers and sisters, bless the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals. God, we thank you for Calvary Chapel and Harvest, for Oak Valley, and for the Well and the Way, for Ecclesia, for Emmanuel. Daniel Baptist and Trinity, God. Too many churches to name by name, but Lord, bless them all if they're preaching the gospel. We ask that you bless our assemblies and Foursquare denomination, brothers and sisters, God, for the Catholics and the Adventists, God. Those that are naming Jesus as Lord, we bless them as you'd bless us this night. Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement. We say, amen. Amen. You can have a seat tonight. I want to talk to you about a message that I'm titling The Rest of the Story, and you'll see why we call it that in a moment. The Rest of the Story. If you turn with me to the book of 2 Kings, chapter number 6, very familiar story. I want to set the stage for you. Here is a man by the name of Elisha, okay? Elisha is a man of God. He is a prophet, and the Bible records that Elisha is consistently just reading the mail of the enemy, okay? He's telling the king of Israel where the king of Syria is, what he's doing, where he's staying, all that kind of stuff. And so the king gets kind of mad and says, what is going on here? I don't understand what's going on. And so he goes and he asks and he says, is this guy like got a spy? Is there someone in our midst? What's happening? He says, no, but there's a prophet in Israel. And this prophet, whatever you whisper in your bedroom, he goes and shouts it out to everybody else because the Lord is speaking to him. So he says, all right, I'm going to take the problem out. So he goes down to the prophet's house, finds out where he lives, goes down, and he completely surrounds him. Now, you may have heard this story before, but it's worth telling again. 2 Kings chapter number 6, we're going to start in verse number 15 and read through verse number 17. 2 Kings chapter number 6, starting in verse number 15, okay, so there's horses, chariots, great army, came by night, surrounded the city where the man of God was, okay, and verse number 15, it says, when the servant of the man of God arose early and went out, there was an army surrounding the city with horses and chariots, and his servant said to him, alas, my master, what shall we do? Now, you can imagine how it is for this servant. Put yourself in his position for a moment. Here you are with a high-profile man of God. This high-profile man of God is consistently giving battle strategies to the king of Israel. He's consistently just nailing it. Okay, he's over here. Oh, he's going to go over there. He's going to divide his forces and come by night. He's going to do this. He's going to do that. And so as the assistant, you're privy to all this information. You know what's going on. Now, you also know the risk that's involved in that you could potentially get someone mad at you. So here the servant is in the morning, he wakes up, you know, and he's getting ready for the day, and there he is, and he's got to go outside of the city to go gather some sticks for the fire. He's going to make the man of God some breakfast, you know. He likes his eggs and his toast in the morning, and therefore you got to go make the fire and all that kind of stuff. So here he is, and he's gotten dressed, he's rubbed the sleep out of his eyes, and he's ready. It's the cool, brisk part of the morning, and he's walking out there, breathing in the air and just kind of stretching it out, getting ready for the day. And there he walks out of the gate of the city and completely surrounded. There's chariots and horses and battle standards. And I don't think that's the king of Israel's battle standard. That's got to be the enemy's battle standard. And there's a whole lot of those guys, and they've got swords, and they look kind of mean. They don't look too happy. And so I'm just going to back up here for a second. The sticks can wait. And, you know, I'll see y'all later. Right? And so he runs back to the man of God. He says, what are we going to do? Next verse, verse 16. So he answered, do not fear. Everybody say, do not fear. Do not fear. Say it again. Do not fear. Do not fear. Look at what he says. For those who are with us are more than those who are with them. Now, he just walked outside of the city
and saw an army. He came back to his master, and it was just the two of them, and his master says, oh, no, you don't understand. There's more that are with us than are with them. Now, in the natural, the servant's probably scratching his head going, one, two, 10,000. I don't know what's going on, right? But then take a look at this, verse number 17. And Elisha prayed and said, Lord, I pray, open his eyes that he may see. Now, he already had eyes open. He rubbed the sleep out of his eyes that morning. He walked himself outside of the city. He couldn't have done that if he was blind, right? So obviously, Elijah is not praying about his natural eyes being opened. He's praying that something spiritual would take place and that he would see something on a different level. Something that was not the present physical reality, but that was a very present spiritual reality. And spiritual trumps physical, by the way, because the physical was formed from the spiritual. Then the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he did what? Let's say that again. He did what? You got to stay up with me tonight. He did what? There you are. He saw. The Lord opened his eyes, not his natural eyes, because his natural eyes were already open. He opened up his spiritual eyes, and he saw. And behold, the mountain, not just surrounding the city, but the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around the city. All around the army? All around who? Elisha. See, those who are with us, all around us. The army of the Lord goes with us. I don't care about no army of 10,000 men. I've got an army too numerous to count surrounding us. Now the story goes on. He prays again and asks that the enemy would be blinded. He leads the enemy right into the king of Israel's hands, and the enemy comes no more into the land of Israel. God wins a great battle. What took place? Here's what took place. Elijah had the inside track on something. What did Elijah have? He had the rest of the story. See, how would your life be different? I want you to think about your life, your everyday life today. I want you to think about the things that you've encountered this past day, this past week, this past month, maybe even this past year. You know, it might have been a tough year last year, and some of that's spilling over into this year. Might be the problems of yesterday or you're still paying on today. And so I want you to think about your life and think about things that you are currently going through, things that you're concerned about, things that you don't know, things that you're wondering what it's going to be like in the future. I don't know how I'm going to pay. I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know where I'm going to get it from. I don't have enough knowledge. I don't have enough wisdom. I'm facing these circumstances. And when you look to the eyes of the future in your mind's eye, in your imagination, you're not imagining very good things. But what if you could just pull back the curtain and you could see the rest of the story for a moment? What if in life you could say, you know what, I don't have right now, but let me just take a peek and pull back the curtain and see if there's some provision waiting for me on the other side there. See if maybe God's got something in his hand for me. Well, what if you didn't have the knowledge that you needed right now, but maybe you could pull back the curtain and see if there was an angel that was going to come and download some information to you, or maybe somebody was coming, God was sending somebody in the natural to deliver a word to you. What if you could pull back the curtain? What if you could know the rest of the story? See, I think we would live life very differently. I know I would. Come on, let's be honest in this place. If we knew where and when the provision was coming, we wouldn't be concerned about not having it right now. Why? Because I know the rest of the story. I know when it's coming, and I know where it's coming from. Now, we don't always get that, okay? And I'm not here to tell you tonight that you can always have that. But I am here to tell you that oftentimes you can know the rest of the story. How many of you would like to know more of the story, if not the rest of the story? That's okay, see, because there are plenty of instances all throughout the Bible. I mean, Jesus had to speak to Peter and tell Peter, hey, listen, you know what? What's it matter if I'm talking about John right now? What's it matter to you? Listen, you just follow me. And when you're old, Peter, guess what? They're going to lead you where you don't want to go, but you follow me. See, he told him the rest of the story, and I believe that gave Peter strength to know, you know what, this is going to happen, and when it did happen, he probably was rejoicing, knowing that he was going to go and be with his Lord. John had heard that Jesus said, what is that to you if I will that he stays till I come? See, he knew that there was a life ahead of him. He knew that there was purpose. He knew that Jesus had plans for him. So because he knew the rest of the story, he was able to go through life. You'll find it all through the Bible. God gives people visions, words, dreams, encouragements, different things along the way, different peaks and glimpses into what he's doing. See, in our life, we need to be ever attentive to what God is speaking to us and what God is doing, because God will oftentimes download to you, give to you, get to you somehow the rest of the story so that you have hope and so that you make it through to tomorrow. Are you listening today? You can know the rest of the story. How? How can you know the rest of the story? You say, Pastor, how do I do that? How do I know the rest of the story? I mean, is it just going to be like, you know, raindrops from heaven or dew in the middle of the night that just kind of falls on me while I'm asleep? No, that would be drool from, you know, your partner's pillow or something like that. But you can know the rest of the story some other way. How do we do that? How do we know the rest of the story? Well, first thing, you know the rest of the story. How? By reading the book. Oh, come on, somebody. You can know the rest of the story by reading the book. And you know what book I'm talking about. See, it got quiet in here because maybe you hadn't been in the book too much lately. See, if you don't get in the book will never get into you, and you're going to live without the rest of the story. Why? Because this book, cover to cover, page to page, word to word, sentence to sentence, line upon line, precept upon precept, is about your life. I heard some very pious people that said, and they wrote some stuff on the internet, because we know the internet that never tells a lie, right? And so they were writing on the internet and they were saying, you know, I don't like those people that preach that the Bible is all about us. It's not all about us. It's all about Jesus. Well, let me tell you something. I agree with that. Yes, the word of God, the word made flesh, that is Jesus. But who's Jesus' body? I'm sorry, church. I thought we taught you better than that in this house. Who's the body of Christ? So if the Bible's written about Jesus, that means it's also written about us. Come on now. This whole book is about us. In fact, you can read in the New Testament that the Old Testament is kept there. Why? As examples for us to watch how we live. So when you hear a preacher say, I want you to take a look at this story and I want you to see yourself in this story, that's not a bad thing. Why? Because, yeah, I can see Jesus in the story. I can see the Spirit of God opening the eyes of the young man. I can see the Spirit of God winning the victory. But also, I can see me in there asking, what am I going to do? I can see me in there confused about life and wondering what's going to take place when the armies are against me. I can see myself concerned and running to the man of God, or running to God himself saying, God, I don't know what I'm going to do. See, I can see myself in the Bible. And every time we approach the Word, reading the book, God gives us more of the story. This is about us. In fact, Jesus is called the author and the finisher of our faith. Do you know that Jesus is writing a story about your life? He's already written the book, and now he's carrying it out. This is the script of life. This is what we should be acting upon. This is what we should be getting into. I need to know how I'm going to act today. See, we're all actors in God's great performance. This is God's live drama. This is God's reality television show, if you will. Hello. Doesn't get more real than this, does it? And see, all of heaven is watching the show. And so if you're going to act out the God script, you got to get into God's book. See, if all you do is surf the channels and watch reality television, hello, you're going to act like they do. But when you get into the book and the book gets into you, now all of a sudden you can know the rest of the story. You can make it through today. You can make it through tomorrow. You know that you've got a future and a hope ahead of you because you know the rest of the story by knowing his word. You ever read a mystery book? Anybody into novels? Anybody like, you know, some of you guys say, oh yeah, Tom Clancy, man, right? You read those books, right? And maybe the hero in the story is going through a hard time. You ever done this? Okay, he's still alive. Then you go back and you read the rest, right? Why do you do that? Because if he's alive back here, I know that what he's going through here, he's going to make it out somehow. Even if he dies, somehow they're going to resurrect the guy because he's alive back here. I know the rest of the story. I know the end of the book, right? See, maybe this too. How about this? You ever watch a movie and the first time you watch it, man, heart is pounding, you're racing, you're like, man, what is going to go on? What's going to happen? I can't believe it. You know, the villain's got him tied upside down, hanging over a thing of lava with lasers pointed at him. What's he going to do, right? And you're biting your nails, you're on the edge of your seat, and you're just there, right? Well, second time you watch that movie, you're just like, ah, he's got this. You know, he's going to do a backflip. He's going to judo chop the robot, which is then going to blast all the lasers. It'll fall into the lava, and he's going to surf that wave of lava over to the villain and capture him, right? See, why were you cool the second time? Because you already knew the rest of the story. You already knew what was going to happen. Same thing in life. If we can get into the Bible and we can find out what God has to say about our life, we find out that you are more than a conqueror, that there is now no condemnation, that greater is he that's in me. You can find out that, you know what, I have every need, how? By Christ Jesus. If you already know the rest of the story, then it doesn't matter what happens in life, right? Because you know I'm going to just do a backflip, judo chop the robot. It's going to blast all the... we won't go there. Revelation chapter 1. Let's go to the end of the book. Is that okay? Revelation chapter 1. Amazing how God gives us such wisdom and insight from his word. Shows us things to come. Shows us the rest of the story. Revelation chapter 1, two verses in Revelation chapter 1, verse number 17, verse number 18. The Apostle John is there in the Spirit. He has an encounter with Jesus. Jesus meets him face to face. Look at this. Revelation chapter 1, starting verse number 17. And when I saw him, this is the Apostle looking into the face of Jesus. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. That's real. It just got kicked up a notch, didn't it? When I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. Look at this. But he laid his right hand on me, saying to me, I love that image. Can you imagine? Here's John praying. Here's John pressing in. He's on the island of Patmos. He's exiled. They've tried to kill him. He's been through a lot in life. He's older now. Now here he is on the Lord's day. He's praying. He's in the Spirit. And all of a sudden, Jesus shows up. Jesus shows up. Guy goes down, right? As dead, right in front of Jesus. Just falls out under the power of his Lord. And there, look at what happens. Jesus lays his right hand on him. That righteous right hand, that hand of strength, he touches him. See, Jesus wants to connect with you in life. Jesus wants to get right there in the midst of your trial, your problem, your pain, and he wants to impart his righteousness, his wisdom, his grace, his power, his favor, his blessing, his healing, everything that is of him. He will impart it to you, how he's going to touch you. And look at what he says. He says, do not be afraid. What did I have you repeat before that Elijah said to his servant? Do not be afraid. See, oftentimes when we face problems in life, the first thing that comes on us is what? Fear. I don't know, therefore I'm afraid. We're afraid of the unknown. We're afraid of what we can't see. We're afraid if it's dark, right? We're afraid if there's no illumination, there's no light, there's no, I don't know the path, I don't know the way, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know. And therefore when we don't know, fear comes on us. And we're like little children in our bed at night after the light's been turned out, chattering and wondering how we're going to make it through the night. And yet Jesus comes right there in the midst of that darkness and illuminates and just comes and he touches us, he imparts to us, and he says, do not be afraid. Now look at what he says. I am the first. Many of us know Jesus as the first, the source, the day spring, right? We know him as the author, the initiator. But look at what else he is. And I am the first and the last. Jesus is the rest of the story. That's why I said you got to get into the book, because if you can take a look at Jesus' life, if Jesus can go through so much pain, so much suffering, so much need, tiredness, all the things that happened to him, people hating on him, people rebelling against him, people who mocked him and scorned him and turned their back on him and rejected him, if he can go through all that and die, and yet that's not even the end of the story, be resurrected and now glorified, then let me ask you something. What is it that you can't make it through in life? What is it that God cannot do in your life? See, God can do it all. Why? Because Jesus is the first and the last. He is the author and the finisher. He is the Alpha and the Omega. Oh, but take a look at the next verse. Next verse just gets better. Look at this, verse 18. I am he who lives and who is dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. That's what we just said, right? Now look at this. And I have the keys of Hades and death. I have the keys of Hades, hell, and death. See, the last enemy, one of the things that we see in the Bible, the last enemy that will be put under his feet is death itself. Many people fear death and fear the power of hell. And yet Jesus says, I got their keys. I have their authority. I have their power. I have their access. I can open. I can shut. I am the Alpha. I am the Omega. Don't be afraid. I have everything that you have need of. You just got to trust me. Can we say amen to that tonight? See, you can know the rest of the story. How? Number one, by reading the book. Second thing for tonight, you can know the rest of the story, not only by reading the book, but number two, how about this? By listening to the Holy Spirit. By listening to the Holy Spirit. See, recently in this church, we've had a couple of guest speakers come through, and we've been talking about the Holy Spirit, reintroducing ourselves, really, to the person of the Holy Spirit. Third person of the Trinity. There's God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. In our present day and age, the Holy Spirit is the one that we have the most interaction with now. It's by the Holy Spirit that now lives on the inside of us, that sits there in the seat of our spirit, speaks to us by the voice of our conscience now. We hear his voice and we follow him. Why? Because Jesus has ascended to the Father now. The Father is there in heaven, receiving our prayers. How? By Jesus Christ, he's given us grace and access by the blood. But how? Because the Holy Spirit takes our prayers, and sometimes they're not even prayers, sometimes they're groans and utterances that can't even be uttered, and yet the Holy Spirit carries those before the Father and makes them acceptable prayers to God. And so as we listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit, we can know the rest of the story. Did you know that that is actually a part of the Holy Spirit's job description? You can find the Holy Spirit's job description in the book of John. Turn there with me, the Gospel of John, Big John. In John the 15th and 16th chapter. We're going to go to John chapter number 16. John chapter number 16. John chapter 16, verse number 13. Jesus is continually reassuring his disciples, listen, I'm going to the Father. You're not going to see me. You're going to be sad for a season. But guess what? Then you're going to rejoice because I'm coming back. But listen, I'm going to go to the Father, and it's better that I go rather than stay. Why? Because if I go, I can then send the Holy Spirit to you. And now there won't be just one Jesus on the earth. There will be the Spirit of Jesus, the Holy Spirit now, living on the inside of the heart of every believer. That means that there are millions, if not billions, of people on the planet today that are believers that have received the Holy Spirit into their hearts that now carry the same Spirit of Jesus Christ in themselves. So now, that's why we're called Christians, means little Christs. So there's a whole bunch of little Christs running around wreaking havoc on the earth, right? You say, wreaking havoc, oh yeah, I'm destroying the works of the devil. John chapter 16, verse 13, take a look at his job description. This is just part of it, okay? There's a lot of other stuff. He will remind you of everything I've spoken. He will reveal truth to you, all this kind of stuff. Look at verse number 13, love this. John chapter 16, verse number 13, talking about the Holy Spirit. He says, however, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, look at this, he will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak. Now stop right there for a second. Look up at me. He says, he, the Spirit of truth, okay? So the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth. But it says, when he has come, he will guide you into all truth. Okay? Now, we have a problem in present-day society because we don't know what truth is. We've gotten this concept that's been introduced into society and therefore introduced into the church because we're so nice and so smiley and all that kind of stuff, and we want to reason, and we don't realize that there is no reasoning with foolishness, right? And so this destructive doctrine has entered into the church that truth is subjective. Truth is whatever it is to you. That could be truth for you. Then there's truth for me because that's my reality. That's my circumstances. So you know what? Your truth may be that people get healed, but I prayed for somebody and they didn't get healed. Therefore, it's truth for you, but it's not truth for me. The problem with that foolishness is that that would mean that gravity is a good truth for you, but gravity doesn't work for me because I heard that somebody was an astronaut and they were floating around. Therefore, that's your truth, but that's not my truth. You would all say you're stupid, you're a fool, and what are you talking about? If you jump off a building, you're going to land and die, right? Why? Because gravity is truth for you too. So there has to be something outside of ourselves that is a plumb line, a measuring line that we call truth, that is truth regardless of whether it's subjective to myself or not. Is that right? Everybody tracking with me? Clear as mud? Crystal clear. Thank you. Thank you. So, what is that truth? Well, here's what it is. If that's the spirit of truth, and he guides you into all truth, then truth is what God says. Truth is not what I say. Truth is not what you experience. Truth is not what the committee gathered together and because their circumstances say that's the way it is. Truth is only what God says. Let's take the law, quote unquote, of gravity, right? I can read in my Bible that an axe head, which should have been pulled down by gravity, floated at the word of the Lord. That means that truth is not gravity. Truth is what God says. Is that true? Right? Okay, so here's Jesus. Truth is that you only have enough bread and loaves and fishes to feed a little boy because that was the little boy's lunch. But that's not what truth is. Jesus looks to heaven, he blesses it, and he breaks it. Therefore, when God speaks provision that everyone will have enough to eat, he breaks the bread, hands it to his disciples, and everyone eats. That means that truth is not numeric, mathematically calculated. Truth is what God says. See, the Bible is filled with examples where God supersedes the natural. Where God's word overcomes the natural circumstances. Scientific laws stop. When Joshua spoke the word of the Lord to the sun and he said, "Sun, stand still until your people have vengeance on their enemies," the sun stood still until Joshua could rout the enemy. Why? Because truth is what God says, not the natural laws of the universe. See, the word of God supersedes natural earthly law and power and dominion. So we got to get that in our hearts, because the next part that I'm about to read to you isn't going to do you any good if you think that truth is whatever anybody feels or thinks or desires at that moment or circumstances, because that's a whole bunch of hooey and that's destructive doctrines and that's foolishness. So the spirit of truth, look at this, verse 13. He will guide you into all truth. Look at this, for he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak. Let me ask you this, what is he hearing? The word of God. Who's he hearing it from? God himself, right? So whatever he hears, he speaks. He will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak. He's speaking the truth. Now look at what he delivers to us when God speaks to him, and he will tell you things to come. In other words, when the truth of God comes, it tells you the rest of the story. See, if you can't find it here in the word of God, see, there are some things that in life you're going to encounter. Decisions, problems, trials that generally you can get it from the word of God, or specifically you can get from the word of God. I know that it's not God's will for my life to have sex before marriage. Why? Because the Bible says, don't do it. That will take you to hell. So I say, okay, I'm not going to do that, right? But when it comes to choosing a partner, who is the woman of God for me? Right? It wasn't until the spirit of truth revealed to me that beautiful blonde-haired woman over there on the front row and said, I've called you to love her. I could show you the patch of freeway I was driving on to college when I heard the voice, and the spirit of truth showed me things to come at that moment and said, that's the woman I've called you to love. See, the spirit revealed to me, showed me the rest of the story, and now here we are almost 13 years later, married today. Spirit will show you the rest of the story. So in your life, you may be going, okay, I know that God has called me financially specifically to give, to be a tither, you know, but I don't know how I'm going to make it on the bills. And the spirit of truth will reveal to you, well, look it, pay this, do that, go over here, and I'll provide this over here. See, he'll pull back the curtain and show you the rest of the story, and now all of a sudden you can make it. Oftentimes, if we knew what God was going to do completely, rather than just following the voice, what he shows us to do, then we wouldn't make it. But God says, trust me, follow me. I will show you things to come. Sometimes God shows you things that aren't good. Sometimes the rest of the story is not roses and honey and marshmallows and unicorns and candy canes and all that kind of stuff. You know what I mean? We don't like this, but this is good preaching, and I'll tell you it is in advance so that you can say amen when it gets good. But you know what I mean? You know, sometimes the Spirit of God will tell you something bad is about to happen. But you're going to make it. Sometimes God says, get ready. A battle is on its way. But I've strengthened you. You're going to cross over. Sometimes God says, trials are coming and it's going to be a tough race. But you will pass the finish line. You're going to make it through. But listen, I'm telling you in advance. That's good preaching. You know why? Because Joseph interpreted a dream where God revealed the rest of the story to Pharaoh that there'd be 7 good years and 7 bad years. Now, we don't like the bad years, but we want the good years. But why do we have the good years? So that we can store up for the bad years. Why? Because we knew the rest of the story. And God gave the wisdom and said, I want you to walk, operate, be circumspect, be prudent. I want you to store up during these years so that you will have enough for the 7 bad years. See, God will oftentimes reveal to us some things. See, sometimes we need to not shut up our heart to what the Spirit of truth is saying. Because he'll give us the wisdom. He'll show you the direction. He will lead and guide you. He'll say, this is the way, walk in it. You will hear a voice inside of you that says, do not turn to the right or to the left, but I want you to go this direction, move in this way, go over there and do this, follow that. See, and God will carry you through every trial, every step, every temptation. God will lead you. You can know the rest of the story, number 1, by reading the book. Number 2, by listening to the Holy Spirit. Number 3, last one for tonight, by sowing the right seed. You say, Pastor, you bringing around the money? No, I'm not talking about money. I'm talking about seed. Everything that you do in life is a seed. Yeah. Everything that you speak in life is a seed. Okay? And we're gonna see this in more depth in a moment, but I want to give this illustration to you. A farmer, okay? Everybody can think of a farmer, right? Here we are living in California. We're not really a farming society out here. I've been to Illinois where there's cornfields as far as the eye can see. But recently over by our house, they started, just developing big plots of land, and, different farmers have been building things up. Now, a farmer, he knows what's going to happen when he sows a certain type of seed, what the results will be. Is that true? Otherwise, those guys would make no money. Because here they would be sowing seed and they'd be like, dang it, man, I thought I sowed some corn and I got peaches, and that's going to take years for that tree to grow up. See, but they planned, they prepared, they got the right seed. They knew that was a corn kernel, and therefore that seed, when it went into the ground, when they put that down in there, that a stalk would grow up, and that out of that stalk would come several ears of corn, right? And then they would take that, they would leave some aside, because they knew that was the right type of seed for corn. In the same way, an apple farmer can take apple seeds, he can put apple seeds in the ground, and when that tree comes up, it's not going to produce oranges. Is that right? Why? Because it's an apple seed. See, we understand this in the natural. Let's take a look at it in the book of Genesis, because this is a godly principle, and if we can get a hold of this in the natural, then when it comes to the spiritual realm, we will be that much further, because spiritual supersedes the natural. Amen? I said amen?
Amen.
Okay, just making sure you're still here. Genesis chapter 1, right from the beginning, God institutes the principle of the seed. You can know the rest of the story by sowing the right seed. I know when I sow an apple seed, I'm going to get an apple tree. I know the rest of the story because I sowed the right seed. Genesis chapter number 1, verse number 11, verse number 12. Take a look at it with me. Genesis chapter 1, verse number 11. Right at the beginning, right at creation, God sets a law, spiritual law, into motion. Take a look at what he says. This is the word of the Lord. This is the truth of God. Genesis chapter 1, verse 11. Then God said, let the earth bring forth grass, the herb that yields seed, and the fruit tree that yields fruit according to its kind, whose seed is in itself on the earth. And it was so. Did you catch it? Good. Next verse. Verse number 12. Look at this. And the earth brought forth grass, the herb that yields seed according to its kind. So that means that if a little cilantro plant grew up, then the seed that came off of that plant would produce... Oh, I'm sorry, I said it wrong. Cilantro, right? That's how we say it in this house. I'm just having fun with you guys. According to its kind. And the tree that yields fruit, whose seed is in itself according to its kind. So when the apple tree seed, the apple that comes out of the tree, produces a seed, you place that apple seed in the ground, an apple tree is produced. That's the rest of the story, according to its kind. Look at this. And God saw that it was good. God saw that that principle, that word, that truth is good. In our life, if we can get a hold of that, it will change our life drastically. Why is that? Because if you can sow the right seed, you can know the rest of the story. Galatians chapter 6. Galatians chapter 6. Book of Galatians, New Testament now. Galatians chapter number 6. Let's take a look at the spiritual principle in life. What is God showing us in the natural that now he's producing in the spiritual? Principle is sowing and reaping. Galatians chapter 6, verse number 7. Look at this. Do not be deceived. In other words, you could be deceived about this. You could have the wrong idea about this. You could not understand this principle. Do not be deceived. Get a hold of this. God is not mocked. This is the truth of God's word. Look at this. For whatever, everybody say whatever.
Whatever.
I say it again, whatever.
Whatever.
What does whatever mean?
Whatever.
Whatever means whatever. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. Look at the next verse. Verse number 8, for he who sows to his flesh will of the spirit? No, flesh, right? Why? Because its seed is in itself and it produces according to its kind. So he who sows to the flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. But he who sows to the spirit will of the flesh? Oh, no, no, no. Will of the spirit reap everlasting life. Notice, as you sow to the Spirit produces after its own kind, and its seed is in itself. Will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Verse number 9, and let us not grow weary while doing good. That's the right seed. Good is what God says. Good is not good according to what we say. Good is only good according to what God says. None good but God. Let us not grow weary while doing good. Good, for in due season we shall reap. Reap what? Goodness. How? If we do not lose heart. Don't give up, church. You know the rest of the story. You know the seed that you have sown. Can I speak a word into your life tonight? Some of you guys in this place have sown good seed. You've planted it in the ground, and you've gotten weary, and you've walked away from your seed because you got discouraged. Tonight, I want you to go back, and I want you to go and take a look where that seed was planted. I want you to take a look, and I want you to see that because time and distance has taken place now that you go back, even though you didn't see anything happening before, tonight is a night that the seed has broken through, and God is doing something in your life. God is moving in your life. Maybe initially you only saw a little plant, but now that it's been some time and some distance, there's a great plant growing up there now. See, you're going to reap if you don't lose heart. Stay after it, church. Continue to sow. Continue to give. Continue to invest. Continue to go to church. Continue to pray. Continue to read your Bible. Continue to get into relationships with godly people. Continue. Keep sowing. Keep going. God is saying, don't give up. You know the rest of the story. You know the seed that you've sown. Now you, like the farmer in the natural, but only now in the spiritual, can expect that you're going to reap from that seed if you do not lose heart. Hallelujah. You can know the rest of the story. So you say, what if I still don't know? Pastor, what if I still don't know? Can I tell you something? That's okay. Why is that? Because there are times where God just wants to be God. See, we can't calculate everything and know everything. In fact, the return of Jesus, something that you would think the church would know. God says, no man knows the day or the hour, right? And Jesus himself said, I don't even know. Listen, guys, I'm just waiting for God to say, go. And then here I go, right? Why? Because if we knew the day or the hour, we would be boasting that it was us. You know, I brought Jesus back. I knew the day, I knew the time, I knew the place. And there have been people who have been kooky and crazy and who have prophesied and said that they knew when Jesus was coming back and, you know, this and that. And they've made excuses why it didn't happen. But see, no man knows the day or the hour. There are certain things in life you're just not going to know this side of heaven until God finally does reveal the rest of the story to us. That's okay. Let God be God. So you say, well, Pastor, hold on a second, because I have a problem. You know, they knew about this. They knew about that. In the Bible, you know, I got into the book. I prayed. I'm listening to the voice of the Spirit. I'm planting the right seed. And Pastor, I still don't know. What do I do? What do I do? Here's what you do. One word. Trust. 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 Trust and obey. There's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Some of you guys who've been around the church for a while know what I'm saying. Acts chapter 20, last verse for tonight. What if you still don't know? You would think a spiritual giant like the Apostle Paul who was caught up into the third heaven, who was the apostle to the Gentiles, who wrote two-thirds of the New Testament, you would think that this great, mighty man would have known everything, right? I mean, this guy has got to have the inside track. Him and the Holy Spirit are hanging out, you know, watching TV, playing cards. And man, the Holy Spirit's just giving him stuff at night. Just telling him, now listen, tomorrow is going to be crazy, okay? There's going to be a little demon-possessed girl, but you're going to get annoyed. You're going to whip around on her and tell her, come out in Jesus' name. It's going to come out. But listen, you're going to go to jail. You know, and we're thinking about all this kind of stuff, right? This would be the Apostle Paul. Did you know that there was stuff that the Apostle Paul didn't even know? Now listen, that comforts me, because if he didn't know, man, oh, thank God that I don't know everything. You know, it's like, man, I feel good. I'm in good company when I'm in company with a guy like that. Acts chapter 20, verse 22 through verse number 24, he's speaking to the Ephesian elders. They're there on the beach. They're talking. And look at what he says. Acts chapter 20, verse number 22 starts out, and he says, and see, now I go bound in the Spirit to Jerusalem, not knowing the things that will happen to me there. Thank God that God keeps verses like that in the Bible for us to be comforted and to know, hey, you know what, even if I don't know, it's okay. Not knowing the things that will happen to me there. Look at verse 23. Except that the Holy Spirit testifies. Remember, listen to the voice of the Spirit. In every city, saying that chains and tribulations await me. Remember, I talked about how the Holy Spirit will oftentimes reveal things that are not very nice, things that we don't really like, things that we don't really want. So he knew that chains, persecutions, and tribulations awaited. But he didn't really know if he was going to die. He didn't know if he was going to live. He didn't know if he was going to testify. He didn't know if he was going to be shut up. He didn't know what was going to happen. Now look at the next verse. Verse number 24. But none of these things move me, nor do I count my life dear to myself, so that I may finish my race with joy and the ministry which I received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. Listen, the apostle was not moved by fear. He was moved by faith. He knew that he had an assignment. He knew that God was calling him to Jerusalem at that time. He knew that there was tough stuff ahead. He didn't know what was going to happen specifically, but he said, that doesn't matter to me. I know what God has called me to do, and therefore I'm going to trust him and go in that direction, even though I don't know. And that's good for us tonight, to remember that when we don't know, we just trust. We just follow the will and the way of the Lord, and God will take care of us. Can you say amen? What did we learn tonight? We learned, number one, you can know the rest of the story how? By reading the book. Number two, by listening to the Holy Spirit. And number three, by sowing the right seed. And what do? If you don't know, trust. Praise the Lord. If you got something from the word of the Lord tonight, come on, give God a great big praise. Hallelujah. Hey, I want to talk to you guys for a couple of minutes. Then, you know what? I really feel like tonight that the Lord wants to heal those that are sick. And so we're going to pray for the sick at the end of the service. But before we do that, I want to talk to you about your heart and your life. Some of you in this place, if you were to walk out of this place and you died, your heart stopped, you closed your eyes here on earth and you opened your eyes in eternity, you don't know the rest of the story. If I were to ask you and say, hey, if this was your last day on earth and you closed your eyes, you died, you opened your eyes in eternity, where would you be? Would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? I don't think anybody is saying, I'm going to hell and rock on. Nobody's saying that. That's foolishness. Sometimes people say, well, hell's not real. It's very real. The Bible talks about it, Old and New Testament. Jesus himself spoke of it. It's a very real place. And you can't just avoid it by denying its existence. It's not one of those things. This is the truth of God's word that we've been talking about. Sometimes people say, well, you know, all roads lead to heaven. I believe I'm going to go to heaven because all roads lead to heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible say all roads lead to heaven? See, because don't you think God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the one who wrote the plan of redemption, carried it out in his son, Jesus, beaten, bloody, hung on a cross, don't you think that if he went through all that just to get us into heaven, he would share with us how to get to heaven? Well, he does in his word. Now, sometimes people think, well, you know, I'll just be a good person and God lets good people into heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible, check it out, nowhere does God say you can just be good and that gets you into heaven? How good do you have to be? How good is good enough? Well, according to my Bible, the standard is perfection. The only one who is perfect, his name is Jesus. And the Bible tells us, Romans the 3rd chapter, that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You're not going to get to heaven just by being good. You'll never measure up. It'll never be good enough. Sometimes people say, well, I was raised in church. My parents told me we were Christians growing up. They hung a cross or a St. Christopher around my neck, had me baptized or christened as a child, took me to religious classes like Sunday school or catechism class, maybe Sabbath school class. And you know, born in America, America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhist, Muslim, Hindus. Therefore, we're Christians headed for heaven, right? Wrong. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say you're raised in church, parents tell you're Christian? take you to religious classes, you wear religious jewelry, be baptized in Christ as a child, be born in America, or that because you're not some other religion, that by default, God lumps you into the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. You say, well, Pastor, that's all cool, but you know, not only when I was a child did I go to church, here I am sitting in church right now, and I believe that I'm a Christian. Well, that's great, I'm glad you're here tonight, but did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say, sitting in church service, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian? It's like saying you could go to your garage, sit in your garage, call yourself a car, and that makes you a car. It doesn't work like that. Not going to get to heaven by sitting in church, calling yourself a Christian. You say, but my last church I got involved, you don't understand. I sang in the choir for a number of years, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions. People thought of me as a leader, and then got a membership card to that church. Now, while that's great, and I'm glad you did those things, just show that to me in the Bible. Your church involvement, your volunteerism gets you into heaven. Doesn't work like that. God's not looking for your membership card to a church before you can enter the gates of heaven. He's not counting up hours, and if you have enough hours volunteering, you get to heaven. It doesn't work like that. Tonight, let me love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough to tell you the truth. If that's how you think you're going to get to heaven, you're not going to make it. Some of you might be thinking, but wait a second, I know God. I know about Jesus and the resurrection at Easter, celebrate the birth of Christ at Christmas every year of my life, sing the songs, and I could quote scriptures to you, Old and New Testament. It's great. I'm glad you can do that. Can you just show that to me in the Bible, where that'll get you into heaven, having had knowledge about who he is, knowing who God is? See, because the Bible records the devil himself knows who Jesus is, can quote scriptures. All the demons know who Jesus is, and yet they're not Christians headed for heaven. So everybody look up at me for a second. This is not about what you have in your head. It's not about some mental ascent towards God, having head knowledge about who Jesus is. Rather, this is about your heart. Jesus said you must be born again in order to enter the kingdom of God. Now, I know our society's made a mockery out of that, but this is not about what Hollywood or movies or television or books or the internet say. It's about the truth of God's word. What does the Bible say about being born again? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means you giving God all of your heart and all of your life. That's simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you in the book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible. We were reading it tonight. Jesus says, when I come, I better find you hot, or I better find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Those are gross, graphic words from the mouth of Jesus. But what's he saying, lukewarm? What's that all about? Well, it's a little in, a little out, a little up, a little down, a little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. And you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So tonight, I'm going to give you an opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three, bang, pop my hands together. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, Pastor, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. And you might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. You might be. Let's get over that. Let's get past that tonight, because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one would make that trade. See, Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'm a man, I'll see your hand go up. He says, I'll confess you before my Father who's in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So tonight, your call, your choice. And get right with God in a safe and friendly place, or sit there and do nothing when you know you need to get right. Your call. Your choice. I've done my job. I've loved you enough to tell you the truth. God's done his job, sending Jesus, beaten, bloody, hung on a cross. Now it's your turn. Will you give him all of your heart? Will you give him all of your life? Who should raise their hand in a moment? If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure in this place? Come on, tonight, don't leave without making sure of where the rest of your story is. You can know that tonight by giving God all of your heart and all of your life. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this? Never said yes to Jesus? Come on, tonight is your night of salvation. Or finally, who should raise their hand if you're lukewarm? You say, that's the condition of my heart when you describe the pastor. Get ready to get right with God, acknowledging your need for Jesus by simply raising your hand. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer, the Love Rock Cafe, or online all over the world, get ready to raise your hand. If you're online, you can click the button on the blue button that says, Know God, Respond to God. Someone will lead you in a prayer, or go to our homepage and click How to Know God. For those of you that are here, let's get ready to raise our hand, and we're going to change destinies tonight. Here we go, all together on the count of three. One, two, three, let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me. Thank you. There's one, there's two, there's three, there's four. God bless you guys. Where are you at? Come on, raise it up high for me. There's five up top. Thank you. Back in the families, is there another one? I got that one there. Is there another one up there? Five, six. Thank you. God bless you. Who else tonight? Six. Where are you at? Where are you at? Just get it up high for me if that's you. Six, seven, eight. Got you right there. I got you guys. You can put your hands down. Thank you. About eight wise people. I know there's more. If that's you, you're wondering if you should. Come on, tonight you should. Where are you at? Anybody else real quick? Raise it up high when I'm looking your direction. Anybody else real quick? Over on this side, there's somebody else. I don't see him yet. Ushers, if you can help me. Anybody else real quick? About 8 wise people. Anybody else real quick? Just pop it up when I'm looking your direction. Anybody else? Anybody back in that family room that I didn't already see? Up there. Gotcha. Thank you. God bless you. Got you over there. Thank you. 9 and 10. Who else tonight? 10 wise people. You won't be alone? And I didn't embarrass them. I won't embarrass you. Anybody else real quick? Just want to give you another minute. Another minute to check your heart out. Where are you at with God? Do you know the rest of the story tonight? That's you. Make sure. Anybody else? Anybody else? About 10 wise people. Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a hand for those 10 wise people tonight. Hallelujah. Okay, all 10 of you, quickly, get a hold of your stuff, whatever you brought with you to church, coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Once you get in the aisle, as we all stand in a moment and give a clap and a shout, sing a song, as we do that, get your stuff, get a friend if you need a friend, get in the aisle and meet me up front. We're going to change destinies tonight. Can't do that till we get you down here. So if that's you, you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand. Let's all stand and welcome them. You come right now. Come on down. Come on down. Make your way to the front right now.
Won't you come?
Come on, come on, come on.
As you are.
They're coming. Let's give them a hand as they come.
Oh, and hear the Spirit call.
You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment.
Oh, come just as you are. Come and
anybody else, if you need to come, you just make your way to the front right now. Come on down.
Come receive. Come
from the family rooms, so you can bring your children. They'll remember this. Come on.
He'll give you life everlasting.
All right, if there's anybody else that needs to come, you just come while I'm giving some instructions. Hey, guys up front, put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing, all right? Came to give God all your heart and all of your life. Going to be born again, transformed from the inside out. And you can know that if you've given your heart and life to Jesus and that you're living it for Him, you can know the rest of the story. You're going to end up in heaven with Jesus forever and ever. Now, we want to help you in your walk with God. Right over here to my right, your left. See this guy? This is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is a really good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on, okay? He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart, and you're going to be born again. Then he's going to help you with your story. How are you going to do that? Well, first thing he's going to do is give you some free information, some free literature that'll help you to find out what to do next in your walk with God. Some easy reading, easy steps to a successful future with God. Then, after that, he's going to introduce you to a friend we have here in the church called the Spiritual Personal Trainer. Okay? You say, what is that? Well, like I said, it's a friend in church who will help you to get strong in the ways of the Lord so you don't go back serving the devil, back to your old ways, that you go on serving the Lord for the rest of your days. Okay? That he'll tell you about that. He'll describe it. Then he'll let you come right back out. So if you guys will make a left turn and follow Pastor Joel, let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.